I want to talk today about aorto-ostial angiography and stenting. Obtaining a coronary angiogram in a patient with aorto-ostial disease is one of the most difficult angiographic tasks, both in terms of properly delineating the ostial stenosis and in terms of catheter-induced ischemia and damping. I will provide tips to circumvent those issues. Also, aorto-ostial stenting is often challenging, but can be quick and effective if you follow specific rules that I will highlight. This is the outline of my talk. I will start with angiographic views. You want to get a view that lays out the ostium junction with the cusp and the aorta so that you can trace that ostium as one line with the cusp as a two-dimensional angle. You don't want something like this where the ostium is being partially covered by the cusp, where the cusp is overlying the ostium. You don't want that. You want a view that opens it as one line with the cusp. This is, for example, an illustration. This is not a good view of the ostium of the RCA. This is a standard LAO, and you see that the cusp is overlying the ostium. The ostium is a bit covered by the dye from the cusp. This was LAO 30. So here you need to go more LAO, like 40, 50, to make that ostium like this, one line with the cusp. So that's a very important angiographic tip. So we need to know what angles to use, what standard angles are for right, left coronary and grafts, and how to adjust the angles to obtain the perfect view, both for stenting and for assessing the angiographic severity. So what are the standard views for ostial left main? The best view is usually LAO cranial. Usually LAO 30s, a cranial 20s to 30. LAO straight, which is the view we use to engage the left main, is also a good view. A P cranial can be good. So remember, LAO cranial, LAO straight, and a P cranial. So cranial views kind of tend to be good and LAO straight. This is unlike what a lot of people think. Caudal views, including especially LAO caudal, are not great for the ostium of the left main because LAO caudal superimposes the cusp and the contrast is spilling inside the cusp over the ostium of the left main. So you're not going to see that ostium very well delineated. Caudal views, including LAO caudal, are good for the distal left main, not so much for the ostial left main. This is an example. See here how the LAO cranial opens the ostium very well, and you see it well delineated as one line with the cusp. Wherever, see how the LAO caudal overlays the contrast spilling into the cusp over the ostium and does not allow proper ostial delineation. Those are other examples. This is LAO cranial here. And you see again, a very good delineation of that severe ostial disease in this patient. This is another view. This is LAO straight. Again, a great delineation of the ostial disease. For the RCA, the best view is steep LAO, 40s to 50s. So we usually engage the RCA in around 30 degree LAO view, and we usually obtain that 30 degree LAO view. In general, in all RCA. But whenever you have suspicion of ostial disease, go and obtain a steeper LAO view. You can go somewhat with that a little more cranial or a little more caudal to improve it in some cases. But the most important idea is it has to be steep LAO plus or minus some cranial or caudal. As you can see here, LAO, steep LAO to be orthogonal to that takeoff of the RCA from the right cusp. Now, if you have anterior takeoff, you need to go even steeper LAO to open it up or steep REO. REO is good to engage anterior takeoff RCA, but if you want to delineate ostial disease, you have to do steep REO or more commonly steep LAO, steeper even than you do with a standard rising RCA. This is an illustration I showed earlier. You see here how standard LAO didn't open the cusp well with this RCA. You need to go more LAO to open the cusp well. This is an illustration again. This is a standard LAO, 30 degree in a patient. You see the ostium, but you also see the cusp here. You see the contrast spilling and you see the cusp delineated here. It's not one line with the ostium. So we went steeper LAO. We moved away that cusp and we opened one line between the cusp and the ostium to see that disease better than you see it here. It's subtle, but in some cases it makes a big difference, and it will make a difference even in this patient in terms of stenting, where you position your stent. This is an interesting CT analysis that looked via CT what view is exactly orthogonal to the junction between the ostial coronary and the cusp. And it found that for the left coronary artery, the best angle is LAO cranial, as you can see here. For the right coronary artery, it found that the best view is a steep LAO. It was a steep LAO with a cranial angulation. However, in order to lay out the very proximal portion of the RCA, what they found is the LAO caudal was better. So that's why it's kind of debatable whether LAO cranial or LAO caudal is better for the ostium. And it is case by case. The most important answer is that you need to go steep LAO to open up the ostium of the RCA. Sometimes with a cranial, most commonly with a cranial, and sometimes with a caudal angulation. The classic teaching is caudal, but I think using that study, either cranial or caudal can work. Keep in mind, in this study, they found that a very steep LAO opens the ostium of the RCA, but that angle is not practically feasible, as the steeper you get, the more you penetrate soft tissue and the more blurry your image becomes. For graft to the right, you need LAO to be orthogonal to it. For graft to the left, you need REO to be orthogonal to it. And you adjust the steepness of that REO or LAO in order to get that one line between the aorta and the ostium with no overlay of the contrast spilling in the aorta over the ostium. If you have circle markers around the ostia, you take a view orthogonal in a way that that circle becomes one line. The next topic, and maybe the single most important topic in this talk, is how to do an angiogram when your catheter damps ventricularize upon engagements, and how to do PCI when this happens. This is the technical challenge we encounter, and I will provide you with some tips. So first, what is damping and ventricularization? This is a normal catheter engagement in a normal artery. This is catheter engagement in a patient with a severe ostial disease or with a small coronary ostia. So what happens, the catheter will fully wedge the artery, occluding it so that the pressure at its tip is no longer transmission of the aortic pressure around that tip. It's rather transmission of the downstream ventricular pressure. And when you really severely wedge, you will end up getting not even ventricular pressure. You will get practically a flat line, as this catheter is against the wall of the ostium or against the plaque. The important idea in those cases is not to inject. If you inject while you're occluding this vessel with damping or ventricularization, contrast will hang and not clear from the coronary and further aggravate the ischemia that's already created by the catheter. So the catheter already creates ischemia, and the patient may have chest pain when you engage. Now, if you give contrast, you'll dramatically aggravate that ischemia by removing whatever red blood cells are here, and you'll create contrast stain in that coronary, which will create further ischemia and will cause ventricular fibrillation. So the first step you get when you inject contrast here is you get contrast hanging in the coronary. The next thing you get is myocardial stain, meaning the contrast is staining the actual myocardium. And whenever you see myocardial stain, you know you're about 1 second or less away from VFib. So you need to quickly disengage that catheter to prevent the patient from going into VFib. Okay? So this is how, you know, damping looks like. This is how ventricularization looks like. And I want to show you what is the myocardial stain I'm talking about. This is here. So this is a, this catheter was ventricularized and it was occlusive. This catheter was wedging that coronary artery and the operator here injected dye. The dye hung in the coronary artery and stained the myocardium, which you see here. Okay, this dark filling here that you see beyond the coronary, this is dark filling of the myocardium. Whenever you see that with dye hanging in the coronary and a wedged catheter, you know the patient will have VFib. And indeed, this patient did have VFib. You know, had they pulled very quickly, as they saw this, they could have avoided a ventricular fibrillation. Furthermore, when you inject in a wedged position with ventricularization or damping, you can get dissection, and that's exactly what they got here. You see that dissection there at the catheter tip? You see it here as well. This is an illustration of ventricularization. This is a more dramatic ventricularization. So there are various degrees of ventricularization. There is the mild ventricularization, where you get a mild change of that catheter tip waveform from aortic to slightly ventricularized, meaning the segment between peaks becomes horizontal, sometimes with a small A wave, like this, or even less dramatic than this. Then you get more pronounced ventricularization where it looks almost like a true ventricular catheter pressure. So now that I explained that you should not inject and obtain images while ventricularized and damped. Okay, so how do you obtain your images in this case? So there are four techniques I will highlight. One, and the first technique is you disengage and you try to be barely disengaged, barely non-selective. So you try to do your angiogram while your catheter is barely out. So you get good images without being occlusive or ventricularized. Also in those cases, if your catheter was deep, as in this case, try a catheter that is less deep, a shorter tip catheter, such as Judkin's left instead of Tiger catheter or the guiding, the deep guiding catheter, EBU, CLS, or Amplatz left. This is an illustration of that in this patient. So here we were able to inject while being barely disengaged. We were able to see the ostium well. We were able to see that there is severe ostial disease and the view laid it out well. And when I say barely disengaged in general, I don't necessarily mean you pull out the catheter. That may be an option to slightly pull the catheter. But more often than not, particularly in the RCA, it's torquing the catheter out of the ostium, so that it's barely out without flying out. For example, to define ostial RCA disease, what I do, I counterclock the catheter a little bit, which is opposite to what we do to engage it. I counterclock a little bit, so it's about the same level, but it's a little bit out. For the left coronary, you can either slightly clock or counterclock, and you can try to disengage slightly like we did in this case. Now, those are illustrations of cases where we successfully obtained images in a barely disengaged position. This patient had 95% ostial, heavily calcified left main. We were able to obtain good images without being engaged here, without damping or ventricularization at all. And you see very good delineation of that in an AP cranial view. This is another barely disengaged case where we see severe ostial disease, absolutely no ventricularization. This is ileocranial view. So the second technique, let's say you could not achieve a barely disengaged position, especially in the radial era where it's hard sometimes to keep the catheter slightly disengaged. It may fly out. So what are your options here? There are three more options. The fourth one is really the most important one for me. But the second technique I want you to know is the hit and run technique, where you inject quickly while you're damped or ventricularized. You quickly inject 1 or 2 cc for the right, 4 or 5 cc for the left. You inject and you quickly withdraw the catheter. The problem with this technique is that there is still a risk of dissecting the coronary. Two, you would need to re-engage multiple times to take more images, particularly to define left coronary disease in patients with diffuse disease. The third technique, if you're only mildly ventricularized, and as I explained, there are various degrees of ventricularization, if you're only mildly ventricularized, you may take a couple of images while ventricularized. The fourth technique, which is the most stylish technique for an interventionalist, is to engage the coronary with a guiding catheter, damp the pressure, then while you're damped, wire the coronary without injecting any contrast, then disengage. And this way, the wire that you placed will anchor the guide so it doesn't fly out while you disengage, and you can obtain your images in a stable but barely disengaged position. This is what we call the hit and run wiring. Consider also in those cases using IFR wire instead of using a standard wire. This way, you do two things at once. You get a great angiogram with a barely disengaged stabilized guide, and two, you get an IFR assessment while the guide is disengaged. So this is an illustration of that technique. So one, you advance a guide in the aorta, and before you engage, you advance a wire in it, and you already have it ready to go. While you're in the aorta without ischemia, then you engage, damp, you're ischemic, but you're quickly wiring, and your ischemic time hopefully is not long, and you do not inject contrast, you wire blindly. Then you quickly disengage your guide, you get the nice aortic pressure, the guide is stable in a disengaged position thanks to that wire, and then you can inject and properly delineate the ostium. So this is an illustration of this technique. This is a patient with a graft to the LAD, and we were having damping each time we engaged, so we couldn't get good pictures. We tried the hit and run technique, and you see here the hit and run while we were damped. And it was quite risky because look at that hit and run. So hit and run has risk. One, you can create ostial damage. Two, we got myocardial stain. Look here, after the coronary failed, the myocardium is very stained. Had we not quickly disengaged, that patient was, like I said, a second away from having ventricular fibrillation. So look at that myocardial stain. So the hit and run did not allow us to delineate the ostium well, and we could not find a slightly disengaged position that is stable to obtain images. So we decided to do the hit and run wiring. So here we engage like we were here, but we did not inject dye. We engaged while we're damped, we wired, then disengaged. And here you see how we're maneuvering the catheter. See how we're disengaging and the catheter remains stable. You don't want to be too disengaged. So we disengaged just enough to be out and not ventricularized. Then we were able to obtain our images. And this is the image with the guide barely disengaged. You see, we can delineate the ostium very well this time. There is a hazy lesion. We could not actually define it well angiographically. Even with this technique, it's just a moderate lesion, but that's the beauty of having used an IFR wire, and it was significant by IFR, so we ended up stenting it. So that's the idea here, is when you do that hit and run wiring to assess the ostium, consider using an IFR wire. This is another illustration of this technique. This is a patient with a graft to the RCA. We tried to engage it. When we engage, we will get a very ventricularized pressure at the tip. So we decided to try to barely disengage the catheter. And this is what we did here. We could not get good images with a barely disengaged position, but we could already see there is a very severe, very proximal stenosis of this graft. So what we ended up doing, we ended up wiring. We knew we were going to intervene here. We ended up clocking the guide a little bit out of the ostium and obtaining a barely disengaged images that are better than when we didn't have the wire, because we had more control over that catheter. We prevented it from flying out like it did here. So we obtained very good images, and that stenosis is super tight. we eventually ended up stenting it in the proper view. This is another illustration. So this is a patient who was mildly ventricularized upon engaging the left coronary. We tried to be slightly disengaged. We could not get a stable disengaged position. Since he's only mildly ventricularized, we decided to take a few images while we are mildly ventricularized. So we took some images. It looks like he has significant ostial disease, but it was hard to delineate. So we tried to do this technique, which is, it's sort of a hit and run where you inject and pull back the catheter. You try to delineate it during the one frame where the catheter is just popping out of the coronary. And you can see here, we try to play it frame by frame and find that one frame. And this was the one frame. Again, it looks at that ostial left main is tight. So what we decided to do here, we decided to do IFR and try also to obtain a stable disengagement of the catheter to further delineate that ostium in multiple views. So we got a guiding catheter and the wire ready to go. And interestingly, even without wiring, with the guiding catheter, we were able to get a stable disengaged position that shows that ostium very well. But anyway, we still wired here and we proved it by IFR. IFR was very significant, was 0.70. But we could have also obtained that same image after wiring while ventricularized and disengaging to obtain that stable disengaged position. Remember, when you do ostial IFR or FFR, you have to always disengage the guide during measurements. Otherwise, your IFR will be falsely high. So if you happen to do here the hit and run wiring with the IFR wire, definitely disengage, not just to obtain a good image of the ostium, but also to do a proper IFR measurement. Do not do IFR while your guide is deeply engaged. It will be falsely high, because the obstruction is limiting the flow and therefore limiting the drop in flow that IFR assesses. After explaining how to do coronary angiogram in a patient with ostial disease and damped catheter tracings, I want to explain how to do PCI in those cases and circumvent the issue of damping and ischemia. So the first and most important technique is to do the hit and run maneuvering of the balloon and stent. The same thing I explained with the wire applies to stenting. So what you do in those cases, you wire while damped, you disengage, you obtain your images. Now you decided to balloon or stent. So you advance your stent, you position it inside the guide while the guide is disengaged and there is no ischemia. Then you engage, you damp, but you get support. And as you're damped and having support, you advance your stent wherever you need to put it. We're talking here, we're stenting, for example, distal disease through a bad ostium. So you advance your stent, then you disengage the catheter to relieve ischemia and you deploy the stent. So basically you create brief periods of ischemia while you're trying to position the stent inside the coronary, then you disengage after that. And you try to be barely disengaged so that you're not ischemic, but you still can get images to guide your procedure. And this technique, the hit and run maneuvering of balloon and stent, applies to PCI of distal disease through a small, moderately diseased ostium that damps. And it also applies to PCI of the ostium. You can engage and damp off and on while positioning your gear and disengage while you want to deploy your gear after you've positioned it and got enough support to position your gear. This is an illustration of such case. This patient had severe left main disease, ostial and distal. So what we did the hit and run maneuvering. We quickly engaged the left main. We quickly wired the LED, then disengage, then re-engage to quickly wire the circumflex. Then we ballooned the left main here to allow the patient to tolerate future maneuver and to be less ischemic each time we engage the catheter. But we kept doing a hit and run maneuvering through the case, and eventually we did DK crush. So it's a relatively long case, ballooning at the beginning helps the patient tolerate ischemia more, and doing multiple hit and run maneuvering through the case also help the patient tolerate the procedure from an ischemia standpoint. Now, another technique beside the hit and run maneuvering, another technique to do PCI with a damped guide is if the guide can be stable in a barely disengaged position, you can wire and stent while the guide is partially out. You would not need to do hit and run in these cases. This will apply to stenting and treating the very ostium. Evidently, if you're trying to treat something distal through a ventricularized ostium, you do need to do a hit and run because you do need the support of an engaged, properly engaged or deeply engaged guide to get your gear and stents down. But if you're only treating the ostium and if you can manage to find a stable disengaged position, then you don't need to do a hit and run with the guide. You can just stay barely disengaged and advance your balloons and stent in that ostium while barely disengaged. You know, the hit and run maneuvering is good to get support, to advance your gear and disengage, relieve ischemia in between, but there is risk of keep bumping into that ostial plaque and a risk of causing dissection. A common question I get is, how about side hole guide? It's an extremely important point. I want to tell you the bottom line answer is overwhelmingly no. But I'll explain a little more. A side hole guide is basically a guiding catheter that doesn't only have a hole at the tip, it has a few tiny holes proximal to the tip, usually 2 to 4 holes proximal to the tip. So what those holes do when you're engaged and you're wedging this artery and occluding it, the side holes allow, in theory, blood to get shunted from the aorta through the holes into that occluded coronary. So they provide a shunt to relieve the ischemia of that coronary and to allow blood to clear the contrast from that coronary. However, this is just a theoretical advantage. In reality, those tiny side holes only provide a few percent of normal flow to the coronary. And rather what they do, they provide a false normalization of the pressure waveform. What happens here is that the aortic pressure starts getting transmitted through those side holes, and what your monitor will display aortic pressure from those side holes rather than the ischemic pressure from the tip. So what those side holes mostly do, they don't alleviate ischemia much. They provide false security by displaying the aortic waveforms from those holes. So that's why I don't like them. You will still be very ischemic. You will still have a risk of dissection while injecting, but you will display a normal waveform that will fool you and gives you a false sense of security. The only one thing they can do is prevent dye stain, so they may reduce the risk of VFib, but they don't reduce ischemia significantly, and they don't reduce certainly the risk of dissection during your injections. So those are the 5 caveats to side hole catheter, and the answer is no, overwhelmingly. One, the flow they provide is marginal, few percent, and does not markedly attenuate ischemia. Two, it improves ventricularization via transmitting aortic pressure from the side holes rather than relieving ischemia, which gives a false sense of security. Three, for ostial PCI, I actually like to see damping. Damping allows me to realize whether my guide is still in and whether it still needs to be disengaged while I'm positioning my stent. So I use damping in my favor while positioning the stent. I disengage the guide until no longer damped. A very important number 4 here, never use it in left main PCI. You do not want to have concealed left main ischemia for any duration, and you don't want to mask it with side holes. If you're getting ischemic during hit and run maneuvering, you need to know it. You don't want that side hole to mask it. Do not use it in ostial RCA PCI because it has no value. You need to be mostly disengaged during most of your maneuvers. Rather, intervene with a slightly disengaged regular guide, or if the disengaged guide is unstable, use a hit and run wiring, which will stabilize the guide during disengagement, then hit and run balloon stent. The only case where it may be used, and I'm not saying it should be used, it may be used in this one case where you're trying to do PCI stenting of a mid to distal right coronary, not left, right coronary, which has moderate ostial disease or small ostium that you don't need to stent, but you need to stent through it. And that RCA territory is not that large. Basically, you can afford having ischemia of that RCA. You can afford having the guide sit in and cause ischemia of that right. One, because it's not, the territory is not very large. Two, because the disease is already very severe distally, so the patient is already somewhat ischemic. Three, it is RCA. It's not left coronary ischemia. It's not the sort of ischemia that can lead to sudden hemodynamic collapse. So in those cases, you could afford using a side hole guide. The only benefit in this case, in my opinion, is that it may reduce the risk of dye stain and ventricular fibrillation. Even in that case, I personally often do not use it, but it's an acceptable option for those who want. That's the only place where it may be used. I will move to the third topic, which is guiding catheters. Which guide catheter to use for each intervention? For the left coronary artery, you typically use Judkins left or Icari left. Basically, you want a catheter with a relatively short tip. So you want to try to avoid the EBU type of catheter or Amplatz left type of catheter. Icari left, as I explained in the past, can be maneuvered like an EBU type of catheter. You can dive it deeply, or it can be maneuvered like a Judkins left and engage from above without diving deeply in the coronary. So for the right coronary artery, if you're going femoral access, you may use a Judkins right 4, which will not dive deeply and allow you to be easily engaged and disengaged. However, if you go radially, I strongly recommend avoiding Judkins right 4 guiding catheter in any radial intervention, ostial or non-ostial. But that extends to ostial stenting, which I know some operators recommend for RCA stenting, ostially, even transradially. Here's the problem with ostial RCA stenting transradially. You get excessive catheter motion with respiration, especially in obese patients. And this is particularly the case with a JR4 catheter. That's why one of the advices I would give to an early operator is probably for ostial RCA, go groin to avoid that big problem of excessive catheter motion. Go groin and use GR4. Now, I personally use radial access for ostial RCA stenting, but I do not use a GR4. I use any of those. I'd rather use a catheter that will be better anchored in the coronary and less likely to fly out in the aorta with every deep breath the patient takes. I use even Amplatz left 1 or 0.75, which a lot of operators would recommend against. But if you're experienced with this catheter and you know how to maneuver it, it can be used in ostial stenting. Otherwise, consider AR2, which may be the easiest to handle. Icari right 1, not 1.5, 1, which is a shorter tip. Or you can use Icari left without power position in a way that you're not deeply dived into that coronary. And by the way, I use a GR4 for diagnostic transradial RCA engagement, but not for intervention transradial RCA. This is an illustration of a GR4 catheter in the RCA. See how it flies with one breath. The catheter may fly, and it may fly way more than what I'm showing here. Conversely, this is an Amplatz catheter. The patient here was obese and took a deep breath. But see here, between the Amplatz and the wire that is anchoring it, it didn't fly much of the ostium, even with a deep breath in an obese patient. If this was a JR4 here, it would have flown out in the aorta in this particular patient. And the stent or balloon we're trying to position would have been pulled all the way out. And the concern here is if you're actively starting to deploy your stent and the patient takes a deep breath and the GR4 flies out, well, you end up stenting way out in the aorta or stenting in the aorta, which is a nightmare. This is an illustration of how I use amplatz left to stent the ostium of the RCA. And if you use the amplatz left, try to use it in an elongated fashion so it doesn't dive deep in the coronary. I use it like this in an elongated fashion. So part of it is abutting the aorta and the length and weight of it is providing anchoring into that RCA. Try not to use it in a duck shape. So try to use it in an elongated fashion, abutting the aorta and anchored by its length and weight. If you want to use it in a duck shape, try to be non-coaxial to the coronary. So a duck shape, but not coaxial to the coronary. Because if you have a duck shape coaxial to the coronary, each time you pull, the catheter tip may dive deeply. It's very hard to maneuver because it will react opposite to what you see. So in those cases, engage, then counterclock to be slightly disengaged. And this way you're stable, but you're not diving inside deeply inside the coronary. For grafts, graft to the right, you want a catheter that points down. RCB and AR can point down without diving deeply. Multipurpose, I use multipurpose even in ostial disease, but you have to maneuver it in a way that you're not deeply engaged. Regarding vein graft to the left, my preferred is amplatz left 2, a long amplatz left. This is an illustration of an ostial graft to left coronary disease. See here how we use an amplatz left 2. Amplatz left 2 guide is best for left SVG. It usually gets you coaxial with the SVG, but does not dive deeply. Usually, even the left 2 is not long enough to dive deeply in a graft to the left. I will move to another important point, which is where to exactly position the stent to avoid geographic miss. That's an extremely important point here. CT studies of stented ostial disease have shown that the stent is misplaced in about 50% of patients. It's either too proximal hanging in the aorta or too distal and misses the ostium. So this is how you should position the stent. In most ostia, whether left main, right coronary, or graft, the lower edge is shorter than the upper edge, is more forward than the upper edge, as the lower edge is at the cusp, while the upper edge is close to the tubular aorta. So the perfect stent positioning implies that you position your stent a couple of millimeters from that lower edge. You must cover the lower edge into the cusp. You do not need to cover the upper edge as blood will flow through the aorta and the cusp into that chimney-created stent. As long as you're covering the cusp and the inferior edge, the blood will flow through the aorta and the cusp into that stent. You do not need to cover the upper edge. And usually use a stent at least 12 millimeters in length. This is different from branch ostial disease, in which you need to cover the upper arm. It's not enough to cover the lower arm. You need to cover the upper arm, which is the most difficult to cover. You need longer length to cover the upper arm than to cover the lower arm. In aorto-ostial, you don't need to fully cover the upper arm, and sometimes it may be harmful to cover it if the stent ends up extending too much over the cusp in the aorta. Here in branch ostial disease, it's different. You don't have a large aorta surrounding that stent where blood can flow and be shunted in a chimney fashion into the coronary, whereas this happens with aorto-ostial stenting. So this is an illustration of a geographic miss. This stent was placed too distally. You did not cover the lower edge properly. And again, try to use at least 12 millimeter stents in ostial disease so that even with respiratory motion, you do not end up missing that ostium. This is an illustration of the stent being placed too much out. The operator here, for example, was obsessed with covering the upper edge, and they made the stent hang way too much over the aortic cusp. This is an illustration of a case where, see, this is ostial left main disease. See the upper edge where it is. This is the tubular aorta is here, and the lower edge and the cusp are here. All you need to do is cover that area. If you choose to cover all the way to the upper edge into the tubular aorta, you'll have your stent hanging all the way, almost covering the full left coronary cusp. It is dangerous and risky, I think. So just cover this area, because sometimes there could be a lot of discrepancy in the level of the tubular aorta versus the cusp. And this is how we positioned it here. We just cover the lower edge a couple of millimeters more proximal to that lower edge. And this is a paper that kind of highlights this idea. You don't want it to be hanging too much and cover the upper edge as they indicate here. This is what they call a proximal geographic miss. This is too much hanging in the aorta. They want it to be somewhat like this. Definitely cover the lower edge, not necessarily covering fully the upper edge. This is another illustration. Again, you pick the best view here. And in this case, it was iliocranial for ostium of the left coronary. And you can see here, this is the lower edge and this is the upper edge in the aorta. It's here. The upper edge finishes here. Lower edge is here. If you choose to cover the upper edge, you'll be way out in the aorta. I used to, early in my career, to be obsessed with covering the upper edge, and I think that was a mistake. Now I make my life simpler. I just focus on the lower edge and I cover it. That's all you need to focus on. And this is what we ended up doing. We ended up just covering the lower edge with our stent here. Again, a couple of millimeters more proximal to it. And we got a very good result with covering it. Now, after you deploy your ostial stent, you need to pull back the balloon, the stent balloon, and inflate it typically at a higher pressure to flare the ostium. So that this will make two things. One, it will make future engagement easier. Two, the ostium has a high amount of elastic fiber, and it's difficult to expand. So you may have stent under expansion there. So it's always important to pull back that balloon and inflate at high pressure while your balloon is partially hanging in the aorta to make your stent somewhat look like this, almost taper up into the aorta. This is an illustration of how we do this. So after we stented, we pulled back the balloon and flared the ostium. There is a double balloon called ostial flush that you can use to flare the ostium. It's like any balloon catheter, but it has an extra proximal balloon that inflates like a sphere and flares that ostium. This balloon basically has two ports, one standard port that you use to inflate the distal balloon into the stent, and one proximal port that you use to inflate that sphere at the proximal edge of the stent. And that sphere will allow the stent to be apposed symmetrically across the aorta. You see how it inflates? You inflate the distal portion inside the stent and the proximal portion starting just inside the stent. That marker is a couple of millimeters inside the stent. And you inflate that sphere to flare that ostium. You don't need to use it. You can just use standard balloon. This is what I do. Fifth important idea, how to exactly position the stent at the ostium. What are the hand maneuvers? So we explained how to circumvent the issue of damping and ischemia, the hit and run maneuvering. We explained what views to use, and we explain where you should aim to position your stent. Cover the lower edge with a couple of millimeter hanging in the aorta. Now, what are the hand maneuvers to achieve that task? It's not easy, because here's the problem with ostial stenting. Okay, so I have my guide and my stent. My guide is disengaged, and I'm not ventricularized, and I want to position that stent at the very ostium. I pull my stent to the ostium, and as I pull my stent, the other two elements, the guiding catheter and the wire, dive in. So I pull my stent, the guide dive in. Now the guide is covering the ostium. Well, I need to pull back the guide so I can stent that ostium. Well, I pull back the guide, the stent that was maybe properly positioned will dive further in. Then you repeat this. You pull the stent back. Well, the guide dives in now and prevent you from stenting. And so on. This can keep happening and prevent you from positioning your stent properly without the guide diving in. So always in any intervention, there are three elements you need to watch: the guide, the wire, and the stent. Each action in one causes an opposite reaction in the other two elements. So you pull the stent, the guide and wire will dive in. And this is particularly the case in aorto-ostial stenting. So what to do to avoid this situation? There is one technique that I love, and this is what I call the palm of the left hand technique. So for that first step, you want to pull the stent and position it perfectly to cover that ostium. So you pull the stent with your right hand, and in order to prevent the guide from diving, that left hand, the palm of the left hand, is pulling back tension on the guide. As you're watching your screen, you pull enough back tension on the guide with the palm of this hand to keep it in the same position. So you pull the stent and you're pulling the guide simultaneously. Not just that, that left hand, the palm is pulling on the guide, and my fingers are pulling on the wire because I don't want my wire to dive deeply and cause a perforation. So I'm pulling on the stent, but also my palm is pulling on the guide and my fingers are pulling on the wire. This way the guide stays steady in place. Okay, so I pulled my stent and I positioned across the ostium here. And you can see us, this is my fellow doing it. So he's pulling the stent and look at that palm. It's pulling on the guide. Okay, watch it again. Pulling the stent and that hand is pulling on the guide. Now, let's say, okay, you pull the stent, but the guide somehow dove in. Well, you want to pull the guide without having the stent dive in an opposite reaction. So what you do here, you pull on the guide with the palm of this hand, while also this hand is pulling on the stent to keep it in place and prevent the opposite diving. So watch here. So he's pulling on the guide to disengage while also pulling on the stent on the wire to prevent the stent from diving in. This is another illustration of that. How am I disengaging the guide while keeping the stent in place? So we're disengaging the guide while this hand is pulling on the stent and wire. Okay? So again, the first technique is you're positioning the stent, you're pulling the stent, you keep the guide in place by this palm of this hand, keeping back tension. If you want to pull on the guide more, you pull on the guide while this hand is pulling back tension on the stent. If you manage to master those techniques, ostial stenting will become an easy task. This is an illustration of this maneuver. So I have my stent distal and I want to position it at the ostium. So we pull the stent while keeping back tension on the guide. And see here, the stent is being pulled, but the guide is not diving at all. So we managed to control the guide position. However, the guide was already somewhat deeply engaged. So we needed, after positioning the stent at the ostium, I needed to disengage the guide. So here is what we did. After positioning the stent, we pulled on the guide with the palm of our hand while also pulling on the stent. And look, you know, the stent did not move much while using this technique. So we use both techniques in this case. We position the stent here while the palm is pulling on the guide to stabilize it. And after we position the stent, since the guide was already a little bit in, we needed to disengage the guide. So we pulled on the guide while keeping back pull on the stent and the wire. And we were able to maintain a stable position of the catheter during the first maneuver and of the stent during the second maneuver. So there are two issues with the stent positioning during ostial stenting. One, the stent dives forward while you're pulling on the guide, and vice versa, the guide dives in while you're pulling on the stent. So that's one issue. But the second big issue is pronounced respiratory motion, particularly when you're doing it transradially, particularly when you're doing RCA transradially. So there is one more technique you can use here that will help stabilize the stent from diving in and out with catheter manipulations, but also it will help stabilize the stent from moving with respiration. So you can use this, and I got this technique from a Sky lecture. So what you can do, you can stabilize the stent with partial inflation, about 2-3 atmosphere. This will attenuate the stent from diving forward when you pull the guide and stent jumping with deep breath. So basically, when the stent is close to optimal position, you can slightly inflate it, not fully inflate it, slightly inflate it, and then take your time to further position it more perfectly. This slight inflation helps anchor the stent and prevents it from diving and moving too much with respiration and with guide maneuvering. You can still reposition the stent before full inflation. You may even do partial inflation while the stent is partially in the guide here. You position it, you partially inflate it while it's perfectly positioned and it's partially in the guide. Then you pull the guide using the hand maneuvers I described, but that partial inflation may stabilize it more. The nightmare that can happen is as you're deploying your stent, the patient takes a deep breath and the stent ends up partially deployed in the aorta. And that's not something you can correct. If the stent dives in during deployment and you miss the ostium, that's easy to correct. You can put another stent. But if your stent flies out while deploying it and it hangs in the aorta, you cannot correct it. You'll have to live with the stent hanging in the aorta. So that's the absolute nightmare of those cases. I've never had that nightmare, partly because I use all those techniques to prevent it from happening. The most important thing is hand maneuvers. Also, make sure the patient is awake and prevent him and ask him not to take deep breath. Ask him to hold his breath, in my experience, doesn't work because patients don't listen. You ask him to hold his breath. Well, 2 seconds later, he's going to take a deeper breath to compensate. And now you'll have your stent out in the aorta. Other important idea here, is there a value for floating wire technique, Szabo technique, and ostial pro? I'll give you my answer. The answer is no. All those techniques introduce a fourth element. Look, as you're positioning your stent, you have to watch three elements, the guide, the wire, and your stent. And every action on one causes opposite reaction on the other two. Well, imagine now adding a fourth element to the equation that can only complicate things. So I will explain each one of them and the caveat. So this is what you call the floating wire technique. I used to love those two, floating wire and Szabo, early in my career until I realized they really don't provide me with any benefit. This is the floating wire technique. Basically, what it means is while the guide is disengaged, you advance a wire in the cusp. And this wire will help you with two things. One, it will delineate the cusp to help you position the stent properly. And two, it will prevent the guide from diving in as you are pulling on the stent. And this may help prevent missing the ostium with your stent. However, the wire does not necessarily delineate the ostium and does not necessarily delineate the cusp. It may be floating ways away from the coronary ostium. And as you move the guide out while you are positioning the stent, the wire may move way out and give you a wrong impression of where that ostium is. It is a distraction. It's taking away from your focus on the edges of the ostium with your puff. And it may actually make you stent too much in the aorta in this particular case scenario where it's floating way out in the aorta. This same limitation of the floating wire extends to the Szabo technique, which is a floating wire with the proximal stent strut hooked to it. This is the Szabo technique. So you put a floating wire in the coronary cusp and you advance your stent over your wire, over your main coronary wire, but then you inflate it a little bit to 3-4 atmosphere outside the body. Then you load the distal strut of that partially inflated stent, you load the back end of the floating wire, you load it into that distal strut. This way, when you're advancing your stent, the floating wire that's now attached to the distal strut will prevent that stent from going too deeply. However, the same issue as the floating wire, it may make you stent way too proximally in the aorta. In this case scenario, you may end up stenting way here. So that Szabo technique often prevent excessive distal stenting, but it doesn't prevent the ultimate nightmare in those cases, which, like I explained, is stenting the aorta. It doesn't prevent that. If anything, it may make it more likely. Another thing, it can create stent distortion because you're inflating it outside the body and putting a wire through it. And in fact, there was a study using both in vitro testing and IVUS that showed that the Szabo technique caused significant excessive stent protrusion proximally and significant stent deformation. And therefore, I really strongly recommend that you do not use it. In my opinion, in interventional cardiology, stick with the basic ideas and keep things as simple as possible. Don't add unnecessary elements and unnecessary techniques. This is another device that can be used. It's called Ostial Pro. Again, I'm not a fan of that. By the way, this is called Ostial Pro, not Ostial Flush, which was the balloon that I discussed earlier that allows ostial flaring of the stent. This Ostial Pro, basically, it is a sort of a small guide extension, almost like a short guideliner with feet at its tip. So you advance it through the guide catheter, and those feet will open up. And as you push the guiding catheter, those feet will be opposed on the aorta. And as you're deploying the stent, those feet will prevent the guide from diving deep and will prevent ostial geographic miss. However, the downside is that if you don't maneuver it properly, you can have excessive proximal stenting in the aorta. Also, again, it introduces a fourth element that you need to watch for as you're pushing and pulling your devices. So I don't recommend it. Just use the basic techniques I explained. An important seventh tip is that you should always verify by IVUS that the stent covers the ostium into the cusp. I always finish those stenting procedure with IVUS of the ostium. So you want to make sure that the stent covers fully the ostium, the lower edge of that ostium. Missing that ostium is frequent according to multiple CT analysis. So how do you prove by IVUS that you didn't miss the ostium? And if you did miss the ostium, you can add a stent. That's why I'm not often worried about missing the ostium, because I do IVUS, and if I see that I'm missing the ostium, I add another stent. Now, what do you see by IVUS? You need to know there is one frame that you need to memorize and you need to see in every ostial stenting case. It is this frame. You need to see at least one frame where one part of the stent is opposed to the coronary wall, which is here, the white, and one part of that stent in the same frame in the aorta. This is exactly what you see here. So one part of the stent is opposed to the coronary wall. Another part of the stent here is in the aorta. And this is how the run looks like. Partially on the coronary and partially in the aorta. Another possibility is that the stent may be covering both the upper and lower border. And in that case, on your IVUS, you may see at one point one frame where the stent is fully surrounded by aorta, something like this. And that's an acceptable thing. It's not necessary to have it, like I explained, but if you have it, that tells you, of course, you covered the ostium, not just the ostium, you covered both edges fully, upper and lower edges. This is an illustration of such run. See how we go from the RCA to the full aorta. Stent is seen in the full aorta. Here, this is the frame that shows the stent extending fully in the aorta. It's not surrounded by coronary wall anymore. Now, the eighth and final idea is how to rotablate aorto-ostial lesions. I described that under my talk, rotablation, but I will summarize it here again. So to rotablate aorto-ostial lesion, one, you use rotawire extra support, not the rotawire floppy that we use routinely. You disengage the guide slightly until you are no longer ventricularized, and you start rotablation with the burr inside the guide. You start burring from inside the guide while you're no longer engaged, and you burr into that ostium and past it. This is an illustration. You start from here and you burr through the guide into the ostium. Now, orbital atherectomy is done differently. You don't want to do this maneuver for orbital atherectomy. You don't want to do frontal cutting of the ostium with orbital atherectomy. If you advance the orbital burr from the guide through the aorta into the ostium, that will orbitate excessively at this point here outside the ostium, and it may dissect the aorta. So you absolutely don't want to do that. What you want to do in those cases, it's opposite of rotablation of the ostium. You engage the guide deeply, you advance your burr, and then you disengage the guide and you cut, you activate the burr and you cut the ostium on the way back. If you want to do more run, you re-engage again, advance your burr, and disengage and cut on the way back. The idea is that orbital atherectomy can cut on the way back. It has both frontal and back cutting. That's not the case with rotational atherectomy, which only has forward cutting. And with rotational, it's safe to start in the aorta because it's not going to orbitate excessively. This is an example of rotational atherectomy of the ostium. Here we started with the guide disengaged. We started burring in the guide all the way into the ostium of the left main and into the LAD.